coming soon to theaters.
Son, I drive my tires over a mile of busted glass just to see that picture right there. Dadgum!
He saw the signs. He tried to warn us. Now, in our darkest hour, he's got a plan to save us all. When it comes to saving the world, it helps to be a little chicken.
What's that noise?
Sorry, nervous eater.
Chicken Little.
Son, there's something I want you to know.
What, Dad?
In about 3 seconds, I'm going to scream like a little girl.
Coming soon to own on DVD and video.
You are the only ladies of the household, I hope, I presume?
There's no one else, Your Grace.
Your Grace! Your Grace! Please, wait!
The beauty. The romance. The magic. Disney's most magical fairy tale.
On the stroke of 12, the spell will be broken.
Digitally restored to its original brilliance.
Talagadoola, Mentrigaboola, put them together, and what have you got?
It's like a wonderful dream come true.
Available for the first time in 10 years. Critics say Cinderella is a sheer joy. It's even better than you remember it. Cinderella Special Edition. For the first time ever on Disney DVD, October 4th, 2005.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Brad Bird, writer and director of The Incredibles. The Incredibles is presented on this DVD in the highest image quality possible. It is direct from the digital source. No matter what kind of TV you have, it can be adjusted and therefore can also fall out of adjustment. To maximize your viewing at home, we recommend that you use the THX Optimizer, which is located on the setup menu. The THX Optimizer provides a guide for fine-tuning your television monitor from this to this. It'll only take a moment or two, and trust me, it'll be worth it. After you've watched The Incredibles, check out all the great bonus material on Disc 2. There's an original animated short, Jack-Jack Attack, as well as scenes deleted from the story reels, and great documentary material so that you can get an idea of the nightmare it was to make this film. I'm just kidding. Okay. So on behalf of The Incredibles team, dim the lights, crank up the sound, and enjoy The Incredibles.
Thank you. From Studio Ghibli, the creators of the Academy Award-winning Spirited Away, come three extraordinary films for the first time ever on two-disc DVD. Nausicaa of the Valley of the Wind. Miyazaki's epic masterpiece of a brave young princess.
Nausicaa.
And her struggle to bring peace to the world's warring kingdoms.
Who could have polluted the entire earth?
You have to save the people of the valley.
Princess, no!
The valley's in danger!
A timeless story of courage and compassion in the face of danger.
What a mysterious power she has.
The magnificent and unforgettable film you won't want to miss. Nausicaa of the Valley of the Wind. Marco Rosso, Miyazaki's soaring action adventure of a valiant pilot.
Here we go.
It is Porco.
Transformed by a mysterious spell.
I only look out for myself.
And his heroic battles to rid the skies of notorious pirates.
Slice them into bacon!
Full of courage and humor.
I'll tell everyone you're chicken!
Chicken, pig, what's the difference?
Take flight with the incredible Porco Rosso. At last, the cat returns.
Welcome to the Bureau.
A light-hearted tale of a girl who encounters a noble cat.
Haru!
And ultimately opens her eyes to a whole other world.
Always believe in yourself. Do this, and no matter where you are, you will have nothing to fear.
It's an imaginative...
Kitty, you want some more?
...heartwarming and magical adventure. The Cat Returns. Experience the wonder of one of the world's greatest storytellers with these three enchanting films you'll want to watch again and again. Nausicaa of the Valley of the Wind. Porco Rosso. The Cat Returns. Yours to own for the first time on two-disc DVD.
Diary. Stitch has been doing really great. His goodness level is way up. And climbing. I've been helping him get in touch with his inner Elvis.
This is the exact bench where Elvis sat in Blue Hawaii.
Oh, yeah. That's him.
But something strange is happening. Stitch is acting really weird. Even for Stitch.
What?
I don't know if there's enough Ohana in all of Hawaii to fix this problem.
All new from Walt Disney Pictures, the sequel to the hit movie Lilo and Stitch. But this time, Stitch has a glitch. Lilo and Stitch. Stitch has a glitch. Only on Disney DVD Fall 2005.
Rated T for teen.
Super strength. Super speed. Invisibility. Elasticity. These are your powers. The only way to survive being the Incredibles is to truly be incredible. Disney presents a Pixar film, The Incredibles video game, available now.
Hollywood Tower Hotel. I'm sorry. We don't have any vacancies. When will we? Let me check. It seems you're in luck. Something just opened up.
The Twilight Zone Tower of Terror. Drop in if you dare.
Welcome to Disc 2 of The Incredibles. Although my favorite place to see a movie is on the giant screen of a great old movie theater, I love DVDs, and one of my favorite things about DVDs is the extra features. With that in mind, we've tried to jam as many cool things as we could onto this disc. There are two original animated shorts, Jack-Jack Attack, which was created especially for this DVD, and Boundin', which appeared before The Incredibles in theaters. There are documentaries about our experiences making The Incredibles, scenes deleted from our story reels, even a rare, historically significant film long thought lost and only recently discovered. You'll find all this and more here on Disc 2. So, pop some corn, grab a beverage, dim the lights, and strap in. You are about to enter the Incredible Zone.
These are scenes that we cut out of the movie.
That's right.
Why did we cut them out of the movie?
Because it had to be a reasonable running length.
That's right.
Yeah. No, I mean, I feel like storyboarding for me is like rehearsing something. It's like putting it up on the stage and having things go out. And you, it very quickly becomes apparent what needs to be changed and what needs to be boosted. And I write certain things to be elaborated on. Like the final battle, I didn't even make an attempt. There were certain things that needed to be hit, but I knew that it was gonna change so many times because those sequences are wild and crazy, and it's the kind of thing where you wanna let story and a lot of people come in and throw their ideas around and then try to shape it. There are other sequences, like 100 Mile Dash, where I wrote every single thing that happened because I had the structure very clearly in mind. And then there were other ones that were kind of halfway, like Helen sneaking into the base,
right,
where certain things needed to happen and certain parts of it I had very clear, but other parts we kind of built into it as we got in and explored it. And these are primarily ideas that are visual in nature. And I think that if you just pin it down to writing, you're limiting it too much. So it's the kind of thing that I think it would be analogous in a live action film that you would develop on the set. Mm. That you would see how somebody's walking and you'd say, try this over here, why don't you pick this up on that line, and the cinematographer says, hey, we could have a great shot here, you know. So it kind of varied throughout the film, but because a lot of my training is in animation, I think I know, I have it in mind where I want to extemporize and where I want to just figure it out in advance. Our original opening that went into boarding was not the way that I always pitched it. It was this idea that you saw the family first as people and then kind of gradually revealed that they were superheroes. So we started this thing at what we thought was a good American kind of way to start it, and that's him getting to know the neighbors at a neighborhood barbecue.
Young married couple, new
right.
In the neighborhood.
Right, and they're making jokes, trying to fit in, and someone says something to Helen.
A commodities broker, that sounds intriguing.
Well, it can be quite a challenge, but I gotta be honest, I eat it for breakfast. And what do you do, Helen?
I'm a homemaker.
This is based on a thing that my wife has had to go through. She worked in film editing, and when we first had our kids, there was a decision about whether or not she should continue working because she made good money. And I said, look, as long as we can bring in enough money, it'd be great to have the kids have a mother around all the time. And we made it work. But one thing that she noticed was that when you're talking about work, everyone could connect with that. Everyone got it. Everyone, you know, hey, you're another fellow working person. Isn't it, you know, this difficult and all that? Once she said that she, you know, was a mother, that she worked in the house, their eyes glazed over and they kind of dismissed what she did.
Throw away my prime years trailing after a bunch of snotty kids? No thank you. Hello, no thanks. Hello, I want to do something with my life.
Wait a minute. You consider raising a family nothing?
I love the idea of a superhero defending, you know, being a mom. Yeah. So I like that moment, and I'm sorry that we don't have something like that in the movie.
The first time we realize these people aren't normal people is when he gets distracted by the argument Helen's having about motherhood and a professional life, and Bob chops off his own fingers.
Yeah. Well, see, that's the thing is if you are invulnerable, relatively invulnerable, and you have to pretend anybody catches you being invulnerable, then you've got to go through a tremendous amount of problems to try to convince the world that you're not invulnerable.
Right.
And you have to pretend like you're injured when you're not. And I just thought there's another side to this superhero thing, you know, the burden of trying to hide, you know.
The secret.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm super. How you been, Mike?
Never better. Thank God for the weekend. Hey, everyone, I want you to meet my new neighbors, Bob and Helen Smith. Helen, Bob, meet Beth Anderson. Beth's a commodities broker down at Philippi Investments.
Oh, a commodities broker. That sounds intriguing.
Well, it can be quite a challenge, but I gotta be honest. I eat it for breakfast. And what do you do, Helen?
I'm a homemaker. Well, we only have one child.
But she can be quite demanding, can't you, little boo-boo?
You know, but motherhood is really much more demanding
nice.
Than I ever thought
hey,
it could be.
Oh, hey, Bob, I'd like you to meet,
Dick Schaefer.
Hey, Dick. Bob Smith. And this is my wife, Helen.
I'm pleased to meet you, Helen.
Hi, Dick.
Dick's thinking about buying the house across the street.
Well, everybody on the block loves that house.
Hey, everybody on the block has that house.
It was nice meeting you, Dick.
Hey, Bob, can you give me a hand chopping up these steaks?
Sure.
Throw away my prime years trailing after a bunch of snotty kids? No thank you. Hello, no thanks. Hello, I want to do something with my life.
Wait a minute.
You consider raising a family nothing?
Well, it's fine if you're not suited for more substantial things.
Do you have any idea how much suffering would fail to take root if more people were just good parents?
Well, I.
What's more important than that? What kind of job? A job saving lives? Is that important?
Yeah.
What about risking my life?
Well, I.
What about confronting evil on a daily basis for years so that people like you can sleep in safety and security? Would you consider that kind of job substantial?
Yeah, I would. Yes, I would.
Well, that's the job I gave up for my new job, raising a family. And nobody's going to tell me it's any less important.
I am so, so sorry. I meant no offense. What on earth did you used to do?
Oh, God!
Call the
Wait, I'll take him. I'll take him.
You don't even know where the hospital is, do you?
No.
Do you?
You think anybody noticed?
I'm sorry, honey. I know what this means.
A couple of months of bandages, scar makeup after that.
Well, we wanted a normal life.
Did we?
I think I found him.
Honey?
I heard it.
A burglar?
I don't know.
Well?
Okay.
Wake up and be sharp. You know you're sloppy when you're not awake.
Yeah, okay.
Oh, and honey, don't hurt him. We're starting fresh. And honey, don't break anything, okay? I just got the house organized.
All right, already. I'm gonna try to enjoy this anyway. Don't move. What did you take? The silver? My grandmother gave that to me. That grandma! What big teeth she has! Syndrome.
Don't act surprised, Incredible. I mean, Mr. Smith. You didn't really think that getting a new life would absolve you of the last one, did you?
You had to know I'd be back to settle accounts. And the best part is, they don't even know I've escaped yet.
You'll be back inside before they do.
Cool, huh? Little something I was working on when you
sent me to the Skookum House!
Good ideas never go out of style, so here we are. Hey, don't bother with 911, sweetheart. I've cut the wires. Just leave the scene, okay? You know, you really should remodel. This place would be nice. If you opened it up. Oh, I like that. Don't you think? It's airy. I believe I said you could go. Now don't try to help him out, you little scamp, and I'll let you live.
It's not your fault. You just shouldn't have gotten involved with the superhero.
Oh, no.
Elastigirl? You married Elastigirl? And had a kid? It's a whole family of supers! Looks like I've hit the jackpot. And you are breaking the law, Mr. Incredible. You know supers aren't supposed to breed.
Thank you.
forget it. He cut the wires, remember?
Do you smell gas?
Grab on! I remember in one of the earliest meetings I had with the sort of Pixar, they call it the Brain Trust. It's kind of a small group of other directors and story people that look at each other's films. They talked about what is the thing that's worst about them going into hiding. Are they avoiding lawsuits, or are they avoiding, you know, people coming after them? Villains coming after you that have a grudge against you, if they found out that Clark Kent was Superman and could track Clark Kent down to his home with his wife and kids, that's dramatic. That's much more visceral. The lawsuit thing is what I always had pitched, because to me that's a very mundane thing to bring down a superhero, which is kind of the whole vibe of this film is the mundane and the fantastic, you know. But I recognized that the other one had a visceral value. So I came up with this syndrome character. And the thing that was interesting about it was that everyone, when we did this sequence, responded to syndrome much more than the villain that had been a part of my original pitch, which was this Zarek character.
Right.
We ended up going back to my original pitch. But the thing that we got out of it that was valuable was the villain.
Who's super now? I'm Syndrome, your nemesis in it.
Syndrome.
Don't act surprised, Incredible. I mean, Mr. Smith.
I loved him invading their house. The idea of him showing up at the end of the film in the house was always in my original pitch. But the moment that I miss is using Bob as a battering ram to wreck his own home.
We took that moment and translated it into the film, but it just doesn't have that same...
It's in there, but it's
symbolic
not...
Symbolic impact.
No.
As we did in the hall and house.
And the moment that I miss most of all is him having the mom and dad frozen in the ray and hearing the sound of the baby and going... And moving down the hall towards the baby's room,
I remember, yeah.
With mom and dad floating in the air, and they're unable to do anything about that. I think we made the right decision in terms of what's in the movie, what the movie is. Mm-hmm. I don't think we made a mistake, but I miss those aspects of this moment. Mm-hmm. And there was a particular feeling that I got from that we don't have that feeling. We have a lot of good feelings in the movie, but we don't have that specific one, and I kind of wish that we did. Snug was actually in the original pitch,
right.
And the idea was that I wanted to know that the villains are serious, and that if you get caught in their crossfire, there's going to be a price paid. So I had a friend, Snug Porter was his name, and he was a friend of Helen's from the old days, and the idea was that he took her to her missions. He was her pilot. That was the original idea.
For those superheroes who can't fly.
For those superheroes who can't fly and
they
have to go
there,
to different parts
right?
of the world, you
gotta
be taken and dropped and all that stuff.
Snug. I'm calling in a solid Yomi.
About time. What's it been? 15 years? I was starting to get comfortable.
What do you need?
A jet. What can you get that's fast?
Let me think.
So for the longest time, Snug flew the plane.
And the problem with Snug is that you had to introduce him. You couldn't kill him right off the bat because then you don't feel anything.
Right.
So then you had to commit to giving him screen time. And the more screen time you gave to him to make you care about him so right. that he was painful when he died, the more time you're eating up in the movie.
I haven't asked.
And I appreciate it.
Old friends don't need to.
No.
Because they trust each other.
That's right.
All those missions we flew, it's unspoken.
Absolutely.
Fly you to some curiously uncharted island without even wondering why.
You are true blue.
That's the kind of guy I am.
I love that about you.
Because I'd fly you anywhere.
I know you would.
Yeah, even if you weren't having marriage problems.
Snug!
Is it bad?
I don't know.
What's your instinct tell you?
Prepare for the worst.
Yeah, I'd trust it.
Fairly early on, it was suggested that you make Helen the pilot.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, I think that was John's suggestion, mm-hmm. is make Helen. And I, like, you know, I've thought of that. And no, I'm not going to make Helen the pilot because Helen can't die. And somebody's got to die and pay a price. And John would go, okay, you know, it's your movie, you know, da-da-da, batten up. But I'm telling you, you know. And so I fought it and fought it and fought it. And pretty soon, just down in the editing room, you know, I got to get it down, and I am looking for cuts, and I know, and it's the worst when you want something, but you know you just got no leg to stand on.
Right.
And it happened on Iron Giant, too.
It did?
There were certain things that I had to let go of that I didn't want to let go of, and for about a week, it's like expelling what are those painful things, and I've never had one. What are they?
Kidney stone.
Yeah. That's what it was like for me emotionally because I didn't want to let go of this. And, you know, I know that I have to. And But once we got it out, it not only saved us screen time, which we needed for things that were more important, but it enabled us to make Helen the pilot, which I think amped up Missile Lock, mm-hmm. because now she's in charge of her family. And I'm very happy with that sequence.
One of the most intense sequences in the movie, I think.
Yeah, yeah. And
it's very
I think
powerful.
That it wasn't, to be honest, it wasn't as intense when it was Snug.
Right?
Yeah.
This is nuts. Somebody's going to hear about this. They shouldn't be conducting test shots. Island Tower, India Golf 909er, transmitting on the blind guard. Disengage, over. Disengage.
I'll tell you what we're not gonna do. We're not gonna panic, and we're not.
Look out!
Whose idea was this anyway? We're dead!
Oh my god! Oh my god!
survived, but we're dead!
Stop it! We are not gonna die. Now both of you will get a grip, or so help me, I will ground you for a month. Understand?
What about the pilot?
This was a strange sequence because it wasn't like a schematic thing. It was more like an emotional thing, like this needs some moment. We need to see the bad guys, but see them in an impersonal way because that makes them even more bad in a way.
Right.
But so the idea was that we, the ship would go down and we would cut to Bob hearing these things take off so that you also connected it with Bob. But the idea that you show them coming out over the wreckage almost like vultures, I mean, when we talked about designing these things, we wanted to make them kind of like predatory birds, carrion birds. And the idea was that you would show them going over the debris field on the water very dispassionately and just saying, no survivors, da-da-da-da.
Debris field all clear. No survivors.
But having them get form themselves into the raft and start heading for the island and then having to stop while these guys came over them. Structure-wise, I understood perfectly that it was a bumpy structure. But it always felt right to me emotionally, and I was sorry to see it go. But when we lost it, we lost one of my favorite shots in the movie, which was the family hiding underwater as these vipers went over.
Right.
But when we took it off the plate of everybody, you know, so many people were relieved because we had underwater hair simulation and all this stuff that's hard to do.
Right.
And it's like you could just feel the beast of the Incredibles go, when that was taken out. But we even animated one scene in it.
Bad guys? Mom?
Yes, honey.
Wait a minute. Stop. Are you saying that Dad is working for the bad guys?
Of course not.
Then what's going on?
We're gonna find out.
In my ideal version, I would have that scene back.
Yes, honey.
Wait a minute. Stop. Are you saying that Dad is working for the bad guys?
Of course not.
Then what's going on?
We're gonna find out.
The idea was that you're showing a guy who is frustrated that he can't do more and that his instinct is to confront crime and to intervene on behalf of protecting, you know, the citizenry. And he's in this job where he can barely help people through
forms and
the red tape
red
of this
tape.
Industry.
Yeah.
Right.
So the idea was to do something physical, have him see trouble almost, you know, that the cops can't handle it, and then just be going, hey, we're all one part of the team, and having the cops not see it that way, and like, get back in your car, sir.
Just here to help. I don't mean
return to your vehicle, sir.
And him actually getting angry at the cops for not being grateful that he's helped them. I think that it was a good scene, but I also think that we had other scenes that were doing that job.
Right.
And it's one of those things that you do in an early draft.
Right.
That you realize that you have other, you're carrying that weight in other places.
Right.
That's sweet.
Hey, hey, hey! What's your hurry, pal?
My little mug. Shake the cops, but...
Evening, officers. I found this piece of...
Police business, sir. Please return to your vehicle.
Hey, I'm just here to help. I don't mean
return
to...
Return to your vehicle, sir. Now.
Hey, listen, buddy.
There a problem here, Ken? Sir?
The traffic's moving again, pal! Get back in your car and drive, idiot!
No.
Helen is suspicious that Bob, their marriage, infidelity, comes together in this one scene.
Some people always felt that it could work. Other people felt like, what the heck is this doing in a Pixar movie? And I felt like there was a tasteful way to handle it so that it would be apparent to people who were older and not necessarily apparent to younger kids. And I think that even if you're doing a fantasy, you should try to bring in some things about real life, you know. And it's not only good dramatically, or you know, but it's kind of funny, you know. It's funny that we are fragile creatures and we screw up and we are insecure, and to have superheroes that are have these amazing abilities and yet have the same insecurities that all of us do is interesting to me.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So it was a little more direct than it is now. And, it had some lines that I'm sorry that we don't have. but I think the version that we have now is the best version.
Hey.
Hey, you.
Too loud? What's up, good looking?
Your suit was gone. Your Mr. Incredible suit? When you were on your trip, I vacuumed in here.
I had it cleaned. What, is there a problem?
Oh, yes. There is a problem, Bob. There's a problem on so many levels.
What?
One, that you would take out your Mr. Incredible suit when we were supposed to be in hiding.
No one suspected. I said it was for a costume.
And two, that you actually want me to believe that right before your business trip you suddenly needed your super suit cleaned?
Wait a minute. Are you telling me I gotta start defending my laundry?
No, I'm saying I do it. The laundry is one of the many services I provide. If you had to have your suit
cleaned... When did you start loving laundry?
I do the laundry around here!
Did I miss something?
What's this?
Looks like hair.
Whose hair?
I don't know. Cleaners?
It's blonde.
It's white.
It's platinum blonde.
It's white old lady hair. The cleaners.
This is not old hair.
Why don't you ask what you want to ask?
Are you having... an affair?
Yeah, me and the old lady. One look at her laundry and I had to have her. Are you nuts? I was feeling good about things for a change. Successful. I wanted to get the suit cleaned. Do you have to...
I'm sorry.
Can't you just... forget it.
Sometimes dream sequences are okay. Mm-hmm. All I know is the first pain reliever you reach for, you know,
is the dream.
Well, yeah, the fantasy sequence or the dream sequence, because basically you're looking for a way to say certain things, and the easiest way is to just say them in an abstract way that is not, you know, you don't have to work into your reality and then right. have somebody go, you know. You know what I mean?
That's exactly what
yeah.
we did.
Yeah.
That exactly.
That's right. Yeah. Yeah. And they can be good.
Yes.
They have been
yes.
good. There are yes. films that have them. I'm not saying that it's always a bad no. idea, but I'm saying that usually I'm learning that they are an early solution that you use as kind of a scotch tape measure to get an idea in a film that you don't have a better way of doing.
Right.
This one is like that, where she has some anxiety and it's very sort of baldly stated, and there's some funny ideas. But basically, I'm not sorry to be rid of it, you know.
I was one of the first ones to go.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Them. They always go first.
Do it, man, because this is going to be so awesome if we get it right.
It's a big movie. It's a really, really big movie. It's been quite challenging.
I have not worked on a movie this good, that I've been this excited about, that has had such talent.
My experience on The Incredibles has been amazing.
Yeah, baby!
That's some good barbecue.
It's so much work. Each shot, everybody has to get behind it. You have to have whole meetings about one part of one shot sometimes.
Yeah. That'll work, yeah.
But we gotta get the stuff to Sim, to lock for Sim.
This is much cleaner than it was before.
She's not that ugly, right?
She's pretty ugly, too.
You think you can top that? Okay, ready?
On Finding Nemo, I think there were roughly 22 sets. On this film, there's over 130 sets and 180-something lighting setups.
All our films are challenges. There's always something. We don't know how we're going to do that. But the number of challenges on this film, you know, and the scale was turned up a few notches.
Every single thing that you see on screen has to be created.
Chairs were built, the rugs designed, the wallpaper down to the light switches.
Designed and built and shaded and lit and animated. It's every single thing. I mean, it's whoever thought about making movies like this was out of their minds.
There's a new one I'm working on. This is called the 800-pound gorilla. He's big, he's got red hair. He likes to scream in the morning. He's the 800-pound gorilla making this movie.
That is not what we're doing.
Well,
you know, you're throwing potted soil on our fat guy, and no one has ever argued with the fat guy.
Brad and I met at college. We were in the very first year of the character animation program at CalArts.
His buddies were directing a lot sooner than him because he's a handful.
He's strong coffee, but I like strong coffee.
We're showing him stuff in the art review, you know, and he said, "Hey, man, I feel like I'm at a smorgasbord and all you guys are offering me is bean dip."
Yeah, I mean, he's a madman. He's great to work for. I always looked at Brad and said, that guy's great. That guy's going to be the best of all of us.
Ah! I'm in the air, you know. God, we're on the journey now, baby.
He's very energetic, very charged, and probably one of the most passionate artists I've ever met.
When John Lasseter, Steve Jobs, and Ed Catmull talked to me about coming up here, they said, we're worried about becoming complacent. We want you to come in here and kind of shake it up a little bit. For them to ask me to do that when they'd had nothing but successes was amazing to me.
Hello, I'm Brad Bird.
You're welcome aboard.
Do you know Sarah McCarthy?
Oh, Brad!
How are you?
How was your trip up?
Good,
yeah. It's very exciting to have you here.
Okay. Oh, good to see you.
Brad, Brad's here, Victoria. Hey!
Well, the Indians, the American Indians, used to, when they killed the buffalo, they didn't just eat the meat. They ate the meat, they used the hide, they used the bones for arrowheads. They used every part of the buffalo. They didn't waste anything. So when I say use every part of the buffalo, it means managing everything to get the most out of it.
The energy at this studio, when Brad started bringing these people in and started making the Incredibles, and so it was great.
There's a great group here, and it's a protective atmosphere, but it's challenging too. It's like weightlifting. Not only are you sheltered from the storms, but you're also fed well and encouraged to pump up. I don't know exactly when I came up with the idea for The Incredibles. The first drawings that were done over 10 years ago.
I remember I had a stack of drawings and Lou had a bunch of paintings and we went over to Brad's house. I'd never been to his house. I thought it would be kind of fun. What if we made it like a slumber party? So Lou and I dressed in our pajamas and I had a big knapsack.
I realized now why Brad brought up a core group of people, knowing we've never done 3D as well, but having kind of security of people with him that are learning the process as he's learning it as well.
You can be on the best project in the world. It's got the biggest budget, it's gonna be the big thing. You know, that means nothing unless the journey making that film is fun.
The idea to make Bob less bald came up. I got angry because I thought, well, we've had him like this for 3 years and now it's a problem.
I hate that because everyone hates it, but they're still going, well, okay, we can make this work. And it's like this, it's all right, okay. All right, it's like that. That's what it's become.
I felt really strongly about it. You know, I didn't want that design to change. We tried hair on him, more hair, and he looked like a jerk.
Now, the kind of verve that we've shown here today should be in all of these reviews. The quick gathering of material, the chutzpah, the moving forward, getting this stuff done.
This is John summing it up for all of us.
Feeling and push through the rest of the show.
A lot of times I'm very clear on what I want, but there comes times where I'm not totally sure that my way is the absolute best way.
Great thing about Brad, he'll take good ideas wherever they come from.
He freely admits that he makes mistakes, and you really have to admire someone who can do that.
He asks you. He wants to know what you think.
Make it okay for people to challenge an idea or two. The good ideas can withstand it. And the weaker ideas fall away and make room for something.
He has influenced the way we want to work stylistically, being able to push things more, merging the worlds of hand-drawn and 3D.
One of the biggest, I think, breakthroughs conceptually about this film is that we've spent so much time trying to give the animators controls that were native to their 2D knowledge.
Wow, you can do this stuff in 3D. I can move the camera over here if I really want. If that's a better composition, I can do that. Now, he's thought these story panels through, and he knows exactly what he wants. But there is something thrilling about once you see it in 3D and you got what you want, But you know, if I moved the camera over here, I got something better.
We knew we were making a different kind of content of movie with a different kind of crew, a different kind of director. We like to think we're blazing a new trail with each show. Every day has felt kind of like a new adventure.
When we started this project, it was all just on piano, you know? And everything I did, all the themes I did were on piano, and Brad would come down and listen to them, and we would get his reaction just based on the piano mock-ups. Score is really about things exploding and people hugging.
So it's those two elements, sort of the mundane and the fantastic, you know, kind of sharing screen space. Those notes make up this movie, like Helen being in the bad guy's base in her super suit, and she can't help, when she passes in front of a mirror, stopping and kind of checking out how her suit's fitting with that very critical eye that women have on their own bodies.
Whenever I go to see a movie that I've worked on here and it's complete and I'm sitting there in the audience and I say, oh, there's my shot. Oh, I should have pushed that more. On this film, they really pushed me to push myself, especially in the Bob and Helen argument. I think I got pushed more as an animator than I've ever been pushed in my life. And I really appreciate that they felt that I could take it to that next level of, like, you know, really polishing it and really pushing the mouth shapes, pushing the expressions, pushing the eyes, and pushing that organic softness in the face, all these things that later, when I look at my shots, inevitably I say, ah, I should have pushed that more. And I think this time they made me push it to that place where I really want to be.
Tony Fucilli, Steve Hunter, and Alan Barilaro. Each of these guys brought something special to the table.
The dynamic between the three caballeros, they created an amazing team of people, and I think they really complement each other.
To the caballeros and their head, Bustamante.
Cheers.
Yeah.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Really what animation is capturing the essence of something and putting your own spin on it. We're doing a movie that absolutely could be done in live action in terms of telling the story, but it couldn't tell it this way. We are totally taking advantage of the medium in terms of pushing the expressions and pushing things to a degree that it would look silly in live action.
What we were able to do is take this brilliant filmmaker, take him and put him into a medium that he has never worked in before, computer animation.
It took me forever to figure out what to look at, because you would have the person walking through the scene, intersecting his body would be a dummy of another version of the person with clothes on. And you're just going, is this the film? You know? And they go, oh, don't mind the nakedness. We haven't simulated the clothes yet. Now I can look at this incredibly bizarre stuff and I can just kind of be okay with it.
Am I overdressed?
We are trying to take advantage of all the great things that character animation can do, which is caricature, which is capturing the essence of a person.
It's not about how realistic all this stuff looks. It's about the acting and what those characters actually are that makes them believable.
If we work together, you won't have to be.
I don't know what will happen.
Hey, you're superheroes. What can happen?
With the kiss?
Yeah, it's good. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, that looks great.
I was making out with my mirror, Brad.
Yeah, it sticks a little bit. Yeah, just a little bit.
Okay.
That's good. Yeah, yeah. Absolutely. Yeah, yeah. And that can help the accent a little bit.
They're very endearing. They're flawed and, you know, they have
you know, these quirks that are very human, so you connect to them, and they also have these powers that are really cool, so I can nerd out with them at the same time.
Show that last thing to Tone, okay?
Okay.
Thanks.
So you should be looking more at her face in the previous shot.
Yeah, I think okay. So. Yeah. So just do that. Show it to Tone. You got him. Cool. Nice
thank
job.
You. Awesome.
All right.
Thanks.
How could any human being deal with Brad Bird other than Tony Facchilli? I mean, you have they're completely opposite, and they need to be. Because I go crazy with him. I can't. I don't know about you, but it makes me nuts. And Tony is like completely calm with him. He's just like,
yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, what if I just lay down right now? How about that? How'd that be?
Brad can never get Tony in the morning to say anything.
What? What do you think, Tony?
Brad will prod him. He calls it prodding the bear. He'll be like, come on up and draw something on the screen here. Draw something on the screen. And Tony can draw beautifully.
I remember I was with Tony Facchilli once, and he said, all he said was, Tinger.
Yeah, he's great because he's accepting of my mumbling and my sort of half thoughts and stuff. I'll just sort of say, whatever. And there'll be a key word in there, and I'll be like, yeah, man. Tony's saying that so-and-so, blah, blah, blah. And he's right.
My hands be closer together.
Well, I think that it's they're going like this rather than up.
But they have this acting room where you could film yourself and videotape.
Mozart makes babies smarter.
Just a little workout. This is for you.
I always knew you were tough, but tricking the probe by hiding under the bones of another super? Oh, man! I'm still geeking out about it.
And then you have to just... Why do you have to just go and stink so... You just have to smell so... stinks.
There's a real trick that we're going to have to... somehow conquer on this film, and it's not an easy thing. I mean, we've done this talk in animation already. How do you show that somebody's strong and yet something is genuinely heavy?
Yeah, there's a big push at the beginning of this film with Brad and Tony and Steve really getting us to think about weight, and by videotaping, I think it pushes you past what you would normally think, and it makes you more of a student of particularly weight. It's a great means to have, because everything we do is so labor intensive, it kind of gives you that improvisational first spark that then you can use to reference what you're going to use in your acting or in your action.
He would show animation where he didn't think the weight was very believable, and he had a real chip on his shoulder about this being very believable, so that you could feel the peril. Then he would show stuff like Bagheera, the jaguar, pushing Mowgli up into the tree in Jungle Book. On one hand, you could say, oh, this is old school. We're the future, and that's the past. That's traditional animation. But the physics of that are so, so exquisite.
The unsung heroes of this process are the technical guys, the TDs and technical leads.
It's critical to have people who can take the artistic and visual quality of what's required in the film and make sure that that is retained as it moves into the technical arena where the actual work is then accomplished.
Because they're kind of behind the machines that everybody uses, people don't think of them. Part of the reason people don't think of them is they do their job so well that things work marvelously.
And so the idea is that Prozone's kind of throwing out this beam of cold, and it forms these particle ice things, and eventually it forms a support and the surface that he can actually skate along, like so.
Prozone! Yeah!
Wow! That looks cool. Oh, that looks way cool.
You heard
nice
me.
Job. A round of applause.
Thank you.
the idea that CG films are machine-made somehow, and they totally are not. It's just an incredibly elaborate tool that is hand-controlled every step of the way.
When I came on to development, I mean, in, you know, development, the film is sort of in the boarding story part of the process, and you're sort of analyzing the boards and the story and trying to figure out what's hard, what isn't.
Trying to figure out how to get the movie made was how are we gonna do humans.
We have to make it possible both to make a large number of human characters that are not impossible to animate, but that also look good, that move convincingly.
Our audience looks at a human being in the mirror every single day. And if you don't do it just right, it won't be believable to the audience.
You know, Bob, a company
is like an enormous clock.
Is like an enormous clock. Yes, precisely.
And we've introduced more, maybe a little more caricature in humans, whereas I think in a lot of other films, the humans tend to get natural looking, and the closer you get to a real human, it looks off, it looks weird.
Getting these people on screen in a believable, compelling way was sort of job number one. And then we could deal with, like, oh, my God, how are we going to do all these explosions and, you know, all these different sets and things like that.
To get convincing motion, to have skin sliding over bone. Bob's a big, muscly guy, so you got to see those muscles moving.
I love working on Bob. He's just the way he's constructed, like, technically, is just exquisite. Like, the model is beautiful to work with. And his design, like Tony and Teddy's design of him, is just fantastic. So he's just a pleasure to work with all the time. And whenever I have a chance to work on Bob, I just love it. Whether he's, like, just running around or whether it's, like, a detailed face, he's very expressive, is rich and detailed enough to carry him.
See? They're finally recognizing your talents. You're moving up.
Yes.
Honey. Oh, this is wonderful.
Yes, it is.
How is Bob feeling in the scene? How is Bob feeling in the sequence? How is Bob feeling over the whole movie? And it needs to mesh there. Now, Brad's job is to say...
You have to kind of work to keep the shapes more simplified.
Okay.
The corners tend to come up, then come down and up again. And you just want to simplify those shapes. So then instead of can just kind of...
An explosive charge or something?
Yeah, it's...
Uh-huh.
Like that, so that we have white all the way around the pupils.
Okay.
Eyebrows going like this.
Yeah.
And then kind of,
yeah!
So it's like, then we cut. Right.
To be in midlife in springtime.
I did not come to Pixar to do a CG film. I was interested in coming to Pixar because they protected stories.
And what I always like about our stories, or the films that Pixar makes, is they're really fun and energetic on one level, but then the story, the underlying growth of the characters, that heart that's in our films, is what I really take pride in.
One thing I love about what Brad has done with the superhero genre here is to make the powers of the people and of the heroes involved mirror their characters. So Mom has got three kids and a husband who doesn't like his job. She has to stretch in a lot of different directions. Violet, this, you know, body-conscious young teenager, has got, force fields and can turn invisible. You know, Dash is your 10-year-old Ritalin kid, and he has super speed. And Jack-Jack is a baby and is all just nothing but possibility. You don't know what he can do yet.
And what I love also about the story, and also how the story has developed, is it's got Brad Bird all through it.
And then there's the uncanny likeness to Brad and Bob, if you look at it. It's an exaggerated Brad Bird. If you look at Syndrome, it's an exaggerated Brad Bird. And then Brad does the voice for E, because he's the only one who can.
If you repress, you depress, darling. To impress, you must express.
Ah, shoot. The thing that amazes me about music is that, you know, in a certain way, it's not specific, but emotionally, it's completely specific.
Hey,
crazy time.
Everyone, your first time you hear it, and it's just kind of like everyone looks at you like, what? What are you thinking? What was that? And then you had to play it like about 8 times, and then finally people are like, oh, we still don't like it, but at least now we know what you're thinking.
Is this new technology going to slow us down, cost more money? Is it more expensive for people down the road, or is it pretty much the same as anything else?
Maybe. Yeah, we don't know yet. We haven't gotten it into lighting yet to test that.
Brad's doing his job to make it the best film that he possibly can make, and I'm doing my job to make sure we actually finish the thing. And we, you know, we fight pretty openly, pretty much all day long, to make sure that neither one of us goes too far astray.
Making new shots appear at this point is a difficult process.
If something isn't playing and you need to make it play, you can't just go, okay, I'll be silent here. You go, how do I make it play?
An animator can't create a shot.
Okay, to me the important part is getting the camera there and getting it animated so that the paperwork can be done.
I'm just trying to herd you toward the finish, you know? Just trying to get us across the line, man.
I'm trying to get us across the line first place.
I don't tell him he can't have with you. I just tell him he has to wait a little bit.
You know? Whimsical.
But you know, it is not.
I know. I'm just telling. I didn't say it was.
I am the least whimsical guy.
I didn't say it
Every
was.
Every part of the buffalo gets used.
Okay. Well, you know? I'll argue with you about Gooey Jack Jack. I won't argue.
Hey,
with you,
did I not
I know,
cut it?
You did. And
I cut it.
That's excellent. That was an excellent decision. One of your best.
And some of your pet things that you had the idea to do don't actually work. You know. Because it defeats this and this and this. And if you are willing to lose this one thing that originally was such a great part of your pitch that everyone laughed at or loved, and you go like that, and all these things go, and they click together, you know, that's what you have to do. And you know, that's the organic part of the process. It's not a mechanical process. And this is why businessmen hate the film business. Because when you're making a widget, you can measure it. Here's the mold. You know, it costs this much for ingredients. You put it on the line and you throw it out there. When you're doing a story, if you're really doing a story and not just repeating the last success, you're just, what the hell? You know, I think this would be cool. I hope, yeah, it sounds great. You know, I mean, you're gambling. God, it takes so long to put these things together, but when they're finally together, you're kind of shocked. It's absolutely done. I have no more things that I want to do or ideas. It's like you're going, huh, you're tinkering, and then the door goes,
Making movies is not easy. It's a pain in the neck. You could do something 12 different ways, you know, 150 billion different ways. It starts on the page first with the storyteller, with Brad Bird.
We gotta finish the script just so that we can get going on finishing the first pass.
Hey, hey, hey!
We were just talking about you and the dialogue for the prologue.
Writing is really hard.
You know, the part where Helen calls 911. Do you have anything written for that yet? Because I was just ad-libbing.
You have this white wasteland of the blank page. You know, there's nothing there. And you have to kind of just drag something into being. But once you get one thing into being, it kind of suggests another thing. And if you get two characters in a room and they start talking to each other, things start coming out. And pretty soon you're like, whoa, what's this? And it's fun.
As we start getting rolling in production, we gobble up those pages and we go explore in the sequences.
Could go in tight, see him tossing a few things, and then cut back.
Well, he'll be totally lit all of a sudden, and then the shadow will just... you know, whatever.
Okay.
You know, we'd work on scenes and we'd have the scene awesome from beginning, middle, and end in this one scene. It's perfect. It stands alone. The thing with movies is no scene stands alone.
It's not hard to find Mark Andrews in any crowd. He kind of
sticks right up there.
Mark's boards popped out like Mark Andrews pops out. He goes straight to a drawing. He knows what he wants to say, and he says it. If you say, no, I don't want to go that direction, he's like, how about this? He's always got a new idea. He's always got another idea. If you shoot him down, he pops right back up again. He, you know, he can't be stopped. He's a force of nature. I don't want to stop him, but I'm just saying it can't be done.
You just want to render this footage, like, useless, don't you?
Story happens when you begin and all the way to the end of, you know, the project. Everything's about the story.
Brad, he has a script that he brings up to the story department, and they, you know, throw around ideas of what this battle will be.
And then the arm comes down, Bob screams, oh, the Omnibus standing right there.
The story pitch in animation is to give the director a sense of how the sequence is going to play.
We cut wide as it swings and boom!
So when you're pitching to Brad, you have to get into character. You're going to be a performer when you pitch because you're selling this so that he can see it, so that he can really visualize it.
We're overhead following him like a cat going after a mouse.
So if it's intense, if it's an action scene, you want that director riveted, sitting back in his chair.
This is Bob gets the car over him as a shield.
Sound effects.
Cut the frozen one.
I mean, the more you lay in, the better. So it's more feeling, is he getting out of it the storytelling that he needs to get?
And then we just cut it to a limit.
Well, it's big.
We make notes and get the bits right, the details of the action, of the blocking, of the story points. Once we nail that, then we go into filmmaking aspect of it.
Doing animatics is basically adding movement to storyboards. It sort of brings the reels to life very early on.
When I have an idea, I don't just see the business, I see shots. It's almost like another character in the scene is where the camera is and what is the attitude of the camera. And you can make the camera anxious. You can make it bored. You can make it theatrical and flourishy, and to me that's like using language in describing a thought.
We give Andy all these parts.
It's a bit of the floor and a slight touch.
Yeah. If it's a camera move with a pan, we don't know how long the pan's gonna be for timing. Andy's gonna determine that, really.
You push in on the inside so the two camera moves are...
Okay, all right.
And Andy's a great artist, and he will fill in, and it's seamless.
I think the most fun that I had was working on the 100-mile dash sequence. Brad has always said we have to have character-based action sequences, and a lot of Brad's discussions on 100-mile dash was, let's just not do the cool thing, let's have that, but also, okay, this little kid is using his powers for the first time, what kind of stuff is he gonna do? He's gonna trip, you know, he's gonna run through a thing of bugs and fall and cough one up, you know, he's gonna do things that a kid would do in that extraordinary situation.
I'm alive! Yeah!
So Mark Andrews and Ted Mathot boarded the scene, and then I get it. Well, I have to do all these dimensional camera moves through this forest, so I started drawing just basically these flats of trees. and then got them into the computer and did some camera fly-throughs of the forest and got Brad in here, said, Brad, how fast is this kid running? And then Brad said, ah, he's got, this should be a little faster. And then we settled on this one. So then these are drawings by Ted Mathot of Dash, just basically a run cycle. So I get that into the computer and then combine the two to realize in true 3D the 100-mile dash sequence. There's not another part of the film where you learn as much about the process as in story.
Going over sequences again and again and again and again and getting parts right, but still parts aren't right, and putting it on a shelf and coming back to it, and it's been a labor.
You feel like you've completed a long journey. You know, it may not be fun to go, you know, through the Gobi Desert, you know, but it's kind of cool to say that I came out the other end. The reason to do animation is caricature. And good caricature picks out the elements that are the essence of the statement and remove everything else. It's not simply about reproducing reality, it's about bumping it up. One of the reasons I wanted Lou to be the production designer of this film is because he has a fantastic sense of flat 2D graphics.
It was really dictated by how far Brad would go with stylizing the characters and still have you believe that those characters could be in real jeopardy and have those real kinds of relationships.
It's not about looking realistic, it's about committing to a design and a character and the animation, committing to that.
When I think of all the characters and their unique frustrations, that's what most appeals to me about the movie. You could really empathize with any one of these characters.
When we started on the film, we didn't really know what it was going to be. It was just, what's the best design?
Both Tony Fucilli and Teddy Newton are excellent character designers, and they come at it from two different directions. Teddy got involved very early on The Incredibles, and he's all over the film.
I usually don't just do drawings of characters. I'll try to come up with maybe a gag I could put that character in. It helps me kind of understand who the character is. And then their faces start coming out of that.
I think Teddy's collages have been a good source of inspiration. The boldness of the design we've continued to use throughout the movie.
I like calling them paper cutouts because when I do a collage, I like to just kind of use it as the colors or the textures. They were very quick and they could keep a very stylized shape, whether it's that little hook on the end of Helen's hair or it's Bob's dome-like head or it's Dash's point to the hair or Jack-Jack's little hair gives him sort of a spring, you know, just because the shape feels like it's kind of a bouncier shape than someone like Rick Dicker, where all the shapes are sunken and Tony would really kind of flesh that out.
Tony comes at it from the point of view of an animator, somebody that has got to move things around so he imagines a design dimensionally.
Bob originated with a drawing Lou did, this sort of Egyptian flat, cool drawing, kind of looked like a combination of a Greek god and Craig T. Nelson, you know, watering the lawns. The first thing Brad told me is if you can get that to move, to work in 3D, I think we've got it. So the first thing I did was do some rotations on paper of Bob and then did a head, an actual sculpture of the head.
One of the dramatic things that just that makes this work unusual and kind of otherworldly is there's all these things that really don't happen in people quite this dramatically, like this straight line down his nose. It's stuff you see, you know, you see people that have something like that, but this is the way you would draw it if you're drawing it very quickly in a cartoon.
If you look at Bob's eyebrow all the way down his nose, it's there's a kind of a ledge there. If he doesn't make an expression, if he's got sort of a neutral face, it almost looks like a Roman helmet, you know. But then he moves around, it's fleshy.
You know, our characters don't have dentures, our characters don't have little hemispheres of white. They have teeth, and some of them have British teeth. They have very realistic teeth.
Well, we had someone actually take photographs of everybody in the studio who would be willing to let us shoot their teeth. With that information, we were able to go in and do stylized versions of these teeth.
These characters, and they're there. I mean, I loved them when they were just line drawings, and now they're real.
I think the characters look wildly different from one another, but I think they all feel part of the same universe.
That's too much of it, darling. Too much.
The thing that Brad did was do the voice over and over and over. When I hear that voice, it immediately conjures up a picture in your mind.
The voice and what he would do, the posture, you know, with the cigarette holder and then. It kind of already gets you sort of in the range of where you need to go.
This is not the latest fashion. This is the earliest fashion. It will be the latest fashion a year from now.
The first drawings of E were a little more like Helen, and as if they were close friends, and they looked kind of alike, except one had a little more of an arty side to her. And we were kind of getting away from that because every character should sort of have their own unique identity visually. That's when we started experimenting more with sort of that androgynous E, the glasses, shorter E, all that stuff sort of came afterwards. Brad said he met Bette Midler once. This tiny little person had like the biggest personality in the room, and that was kind of what he wanted from this character.
E, to me, is a very small person that is very powerful. She has this way of walking into any situation and with seemingly no effort at all, completely blowing over it. She is the only one in the film that makes superheroes uneasy. They're used to being the most confident people in the room. But when they get in the room with E, suddenly they're flustered, they're a little off base, they don't know quite how to deal with her. Even though she's a fraction of their size, her sense of self is probably the most strong of any character in the movie.
There's just a lot in this movie. I mean, when we first saw the reels, I mean, I think people were like, oh, Lord, how are we gonna
do humans? And how are they gonna look? And are they gonna be believable?
Brad wanted a very stylized human. And that's always tricky, you know, finding your place on that realistic to stylized line that's both believable and compelling, but still cartoony and appealing.
It needs to not be disturbing, but yet still feel like it's alive, and that's a pretty tough thing to do.
There's two responses you get from TDs, typically. You know, first is like, that's really cool, and then the next one is like, oh my lord, how are we gonna do it? They've all got hair, they've all got clothes, you know? It's like, they've got 5 changes of clothing.
We have something like 95 costume changes, and not just T-shirts, but suits and shirts and ties and belts and pants and all of them interacting with each other.
And they had to look like different kinds of material, and, you know, that was huge.
We had to bring in a tailor, Maria, and have her train us on how to do flat pattern making. In my own experiences of sewing, I really didn't have to think about the extreme forms and how to cut patterns for characters with 13 centimeter waists. We measured everything you can imagine except probably the face and the fingers and the toes. We took all those measurements and then we would draft the patterns. And so after we create the mesh, it comes out all funny looking and puffed out, and we have to go through the process of running the simulator to relax it onto the body, and you just start plussing it by iterating the patterns. And once you go through that about 100 times, you usually end up something that you're happy with.
This is a hobo suit, darling. You can't be seen in this. I won't allow it.
And then they all have hair. Hair's hard. Computer graphics, you know, there are hard problems. Water's hard. Fire's hard. Hair's hard.
Violet has this long, black, dark hair, which has to move when she moves and move believably.
Simulation of long hair is just one of those, you know, oh, it's one of those problems that people start to freak about when you talk about it.
It just brought the production to its knees for a long time, where we kept trying and kept trying and kept trying and couldn't do it. And finally, we had this summit where the big brain guys who run the simulator, the thing that makes the hair move, you know, finally just sat across the table and said, well, you know, John, I got to tell you, long hair is theoretical at this point. Whoa, time out, theoretical? You know, the movie comes out in less than a year. You know, what do you mean it's theoretical?
Certainly there were some moments of doubt, but everybody wants to believe that they can do it. The question is, can you do it given the time that you have and the people that you have?
Long hair is really hard. What really happens is you have millions of hairs that are interacting with each other, and that's what gives it its shape.
Each hair likes to grab onto the neighboring hair and not move or to carry it with, so that they all kind of move together.
You can't really do that on the computer. It's simply too much. We tried a lot of things that really didn't work and just looked silly. And when we finally figured out what the problem was, it was fine.
They pulled it off. It's beautiful. I mean, her hair moves in a way that we never thought would be possible. And, you know, pop the champagne corks, you know, clap everybody on the back, get a patent, you know?
Okay, well, yeah, once we get this hair problem solved, we also have to do wet hair and wind in hair and, you know, that sort of thing.
Officers, ma'am, Squeaker.
Bob is a superhero. He's muscular. You expect to see that musculature move in maybe not a realistic way, but in a believable way.
We had to build a skeleton. We had to put muscles on top of it. Those muscles had to be able to flex and bulge, and you had to be able to see them.
I mean, we do not have every bone in the body or anything like that. I mean, that would have been overkill. I mean, Brad wasn't going for hyper-realism.
This is a cartoon, and so we wanted to just hint at reality and not try to duplicate it. Mm-hmm. And that's sort of our overriding theme for designing these puppets.
Yeah, just as our characters are caricatures of human, our muscles are also caricatures of muscles.
The fine-scale detail really sells it as being a human and being realistic. Facial pores, facial hair, pimples. Brad and Lou were clear on from the beginning that he didn't want any of that. He didn't want that facial detail.
Subsurface scattering is a mechanism for adding translucency to objects and sort of modeling the, you know, intrinsic nature of translucent objects.
So we applied that same kind of a physics of the light bouncing around inside the surface to all the skin of our characters, and that was kind of how we got there.
Having the actual material, the skin, feel organic and alive would allow us to get away with less of the, you know, minute detail. All techno speak aside, what you really see is you see softer shadows. Intuitively, the material feels more alive because it doesn't feel like a hard plastic surface. It feels like light goes into it and transmits through it.
It's just there a little bit subliminally, and you may not even notice it in a still, but when the characters move in the light, it's part of what sells them as being alive.
I mean, it all comes together to kick up the believability a notch. It's like they're puppets, but they're alive, but they're puppets, but they're alive.
Just making it so that you can have everything fall into its appropriate place for the story and not draw attention to itself is a real challenge.
And I think you see it on the screen. I think you see it in the acting. I think, you know, we made them a violin and they play it. And that's pretty rewarding to me. Universal Man. Everyone loves and hates Universal Man.
I'm trying to make an attractive teenage girl. And the problem is, this...
She looked like a jelly bean.
Well, the thing is, what happened was we built a universal man to make all the men.
Yes.
And then we took the man and shaped it into a woman.
See? It's always the
and
man.
And that's the problem.
It's always the man.
The men are messing things up.
The scope of the film is gigantic. We're trying to figure out what can we do. We have all these crowds to fill. We have all these secondary characters. We're running out of time and money.
We couldn't build each of them individually, okay? Clearly, you know, you've got hundreds, at least, of miscellaneous people. You can't build an individual model. But you still have to people the world.
Our approach was to try and make kind of generic guy that could then turn into, you know, all the faces in the supporting cast.
Just Universal Man is all over the place. So, for example, the principal and Bernie are the same model. All the people in the stands are the same model. All the kids at the racetrack are Universal Men. The Underminer, he started from Universal Man.
We've taken him all the way.
That's amazing.
Way away from a normal proportioned person at this
right.
point. So, yeah. I'm surprised it works at all. There's firemen, there's cops, you know, bystanders, muggers, victims, miscellaneous supers, you name it. Oh, don't worry, you'll never see him up close. And then suddenly Bernie, who's a background character or a miscellaneous character, he's built from Universal Man. He's full frame, you know, he's like right in camera filling the frame. Oh, yeah, except for Bernie and those cops and that mugger. You know, after having finished this film, I believe completely in my bones, there's no such thing as a background character.
One of the challenges of the film was just the scope of it. We had a shot underwater, shots in the jungle, shots in a boring office cubicle, shots around the family dinner table, E's house, which is like Bauhaus meets Greek ruins. The variety of environments in this movie was enormous.
I'm not going to comment on what era the film is set in. You know, that time.
This film is set in a sort of an alternate universe, mid-60s world. And it's meant to kind of evoke the futurism of that age, but in a sort of timeless way.
A lot of the early influences were definitely 60s architecture.
There was a belief that the future was firmly, you know, in the grasp. If you were a kid back then, you know, hey man, by the time I'm growing up, we're going to be going to work in jetpacks. That idea of this kind of technically believable future that never really quite arrived.
With the retro style of the film, we didn't want it to be purely as though we were doing a historical piece, but trying to design the future from the perspective of the 1960s. In the beginning, there were ideas of, well, how futuristic is the world? How futuristic is the home versus the island? You know, do they have flying cars? At some point we realized we had to bring it in into more of reality and base it in more of what people were familiar with.
The key idea of the film is to have the mundane and the fantastic and have these things, you know, kind of interlock. So we also tried to make environments that were fantastic right next to things that were very everyday.
I worked really hard with Lou to try to get the house environment to feel very homey and familiar. We tried really hard to get sort of a feminine touch. You know, everything that is in the house was probably put together by Helen.
If everything was so fantastic and futuristic, their being superheroes wouldn't be as super, I think. So that when we do get to the island, what is futuristic about it is more amazing, I think, through the eyes of Bob.
It's because the emotions in the film are kind of broad and you know, we are doing superheroes after all, that I wanted to have a really wide range of environments and still make it feel unified, like it was all one thing.
People sometimes say that film is a visual medium, but in fact, it really doesn't function without sound.
Sound, I think, is tremendously important to the success of a film. I think that a great deal of how an audience experiences a film is through sound.
The challenging thing about the animated film is that you have to entirely invent the world. I had to fabricate more new sounds for The Incredibles than any other film I've ever worked on. I was amazed at the number of gadgets and devices and processes and vehicles in this movie. One of the key scenes in the movie involves these velocipods chasing Dash. None of us knew exactly what the velocipods were going to sound like, but we knew that they had to sound dangerous because that scene doesn't work unless we think that those things are about to chew him up and spit him out any second. The visual design of the velocipods is such that it almost looks like they have knives spinning around them. So I took that metaphor and ran with it a little bit, and we recorded knives being sharpened and sharp pieces of metal rubbing against each other. And one of the key elements, it turns out, in the velocipods is exactly that. It's a modified version of knives being sharp. Foley is one of the ways that you can make sounds for movies. And it involves performers who are essentially like dancers, watching the action on the screen, walking in sync with the actors on the screen, or manipulating objects to make the sounds for the scene. Foley performers get very good at being creative with props, maybe using a slightly larger prop or a more interesting sounding prop than the one that you see on the screen, but in the end, the sound is more interesting or enticing or useful.
Oh. Ah. Must be Mrs. Incredible.
That was pretty good. That was pretty good, didn't you think?
Yeah.
And the thing is I don't want to lose any impact, but I kind of feel like we're losing impact because everything's up.
Right.
You know?
The cliche is that sound sneaks in the side door to the brain, meaning that you don't really notice how it's affecting you. It's almost always the way you want it to be, because once the audience starts consciously thinking about, oh, well, that's a cool sound, or that's a powerful sound, in a way you've lost them from the story of the movie. So the trick is to make the sounds useful to the scene, but not make them so attention-getting that they snap you out of the dream of the movie.
Forget that 3-4. Just go right into 4-4.
Play it around, it's so important.
Yeah. 8 into 43.
guess this is loud at the beginning.
It's loud. Well, no, mezzo forte.
Okay.
One more rehearsal. Like Wayne did for his child, save yourselves, Chris.
One, two, three, four, five, six.
Most of the time, we're just there as color stuff. This movie, the whole brass, all the brass, French horns, trombones, tubas, everything, are so out front and so in your face, so...
Energy that was here, creativity, use of pulling together so many things, the great atmosphere on the scoring stage.
I like things to be relaxed. I like to have a good time. I love what I'm doing, and I want everyone else on the team and around me to kind of feel that same way. After I met with Tim, I was like, this guy's going to help me convey that to everybody. Tim and I have worked on everything ever since, and I can't imagine working on something without him at this point.
This has been his and my, you know, greatest opportunity to do something really, a great project that we love, and it was fun.
I was looking for a specific sound, and it was kind of keyed into the design of the movie, which is kind of the future as seen from the mid-60s, sort of. It's supposed to be kind of a period, but also timeless. So I was looking for the equivalent in the music as well.
When I first met him, he knew the style, the feel of the music that he wanted, quasi-jazz orchestra things. And which rarely, you know, doesn't really happen that much more. It's usually, if it does happen now, it's kind of infused with techno elements and something very modern. But what he wanted was something just purely of that era.
Brad wanted that analog sound. That 60s kind of a sound. And brass definitely does sound better on tape than it does on digital. I've been mixing sound since 1946, and I got into film in 1964, I think.
There was a very different way of recording then than they do now. Now everything is so separated, and they do think they don't have the orchestra all together. Dan is an engineer that came from the days when they used to do it what I consider the right way. You have everyone in the room, you have everyone playing against each other, they feed off each other's energy, and the pieces are so much more musical because of that. And that's why I work with Dan, because he gives me the sound that I know from growing up as a kid listening to music. Yeah, but I think we should get one. Let's just do it again and we'll be done with it.
One more.
Only one more. Yeah, yeah.
When describing lighting, the first thing that I like to talk about is just the functionality of lighting. And the best way to think about it in terms of a real-world example is that when you come home late at night, the first thing that you do is flip on the light so you can see in front of you and see what you're doing. So we have lights that serve a functional purpose. Basically, they're working lights. All of the departments upstream, layout, set dressing, shading, animation, they all use it so they can see what they're doing. But if you were going to watch a whole movie with just these white lights, it'd probably be pretty boring. It's not very interesting to look at, and it doesn't do anything to really pull you into the world that the characters are existing in. So when we're starting to construct a scene, we don't even start with the white camera lights here. We just start from a blank slate. So where I like to start is with the key light. I knew that the center of attention would be here where the kids are, so I wanted to focus on that area, make that the brightest part of the composition. The other motivating light source is the big blue sky, and basically it serves as this big blue fill. And so that's the next thing that I add in. But the scene is still dark. It still has areas of black that are not really quite being filled in enough. So then we place in some light kind of bouncing up from these bright areas on the ground, and then there's our final scene. Brad, Lou, and I would get together and talk about what is the story point, what's the mood, what are we trying to support, or what are we trying to communicate. Bob in the office, obviously he's not having the best time of his life. We definitely chose for this to be the most monochromatic scene to show this is not the most joyful place for him, as opposed to later, when things are looking up for him, he's feeling a little bit better about himself, we have sunlight washing in, everything's golden to support that part of the story. And then here's Bob in the torture sequence where Syndrome has captured him and the lighting is kind of a cool, sickly color, like it's not a very pleasing cool, it's kind of sterile. Here, of course, is how it was lit for the movie, but just giving a different example, what if we decided to light this warm and a little less contrasty? Obviously, approaching it this way, it looks more pleasant than what we really want to communicate, which is a high conflict, unpleasant situation. All of these things kind of go in to communicate the story point and help us to heighten the emotional impact of a scene using light.
Intruder alert. Intruder alert.
Tools is a really interesting place. We do technology in service of a director's vision.
The tools guys are amazing, but they are kind of the unsung heroes of a project like this because they tend to be kind of quiet and behind the scenes, a lot of them.
Studio Tools creates the software that the rest of the company uses for its creative work. We write the software that the modelers use to actually create the models, and we write the software that the layout people use to initially position the models in the scene, and that the animators use to make the models perform, and that the lighting people use to light the scene and then render the final result.
When they started to think about what it was going to take to do this film, one of the big issues was, oh man, we got humans. Now, the reason humans are tricky is you're one, I'm one, and all of a sudden we have expectations about how those humans are supposed to behave, how they're supposed to look, what their attributes are.
So we had to build some specialized controls for these characters that would let them do things that none of our characters had done before. A lot of stretching and morphing and getting mushed around. The characters had to be much more malleable.
We've got characters that got big honking muscles. We got characters that have some mass. So when I start running,
showtime.
I want to be able to control that mass, finesse that mass, such that I can actually have a jiggle. So we started to look at what kind of jiggle controls we would have. We have characters that have supernatural arms, stretchy, movie, bendy kinds of things. So we started to look at being able to provide some things that would allow them to bend and bow the arm, be able to squetch that arm, which is really combining the idea of squashing and stretching. Fundamentals of animation, but now customized for humans.
Not only do they want big, stretchy arms, but they wanted to be able to do things like completely flatten the character and not just flat, but curved against, flattened against the inside of a curved shape, the inside of the cylinder here. And to make it a little bit harder, not only does she have to get flattened like that, but she has to do some acting when she's up against the wall, see her hair and her eyes moving around. So we wanted a program that would let the animators essentially distort space, kind of like a wormhole.
So The Incredibles is not only an incredible film, but it's an incredible technological feat as well.
If I did what they were doing, I'd be going, hey, I just made a miracle happen. Come on, little respect here. But these guys are quiet, and they just they make these films absolutely possible.
Robert Parr, will you have this woman to be your lawful wedded wife?
Cool, I'm ready for take it!
Fly home, but I work alone.
Hi, Tony.
Hey. You're a rabbit, right?
Sarah Vowell, and I am a superhero. I think that's obvious. This is my superheroic lair. Behind me, perhaps you will notice my superheroic map of the United States autumnal wind patterns, my superheroic courier knives print of the Lincoln assassination, the super, super heroic photograph of American and Canadian diplomats settling the Alaska boundary dispute in 1903, and one of my prized possessions, the superheroic hair of abolitionist guerrilla warrior John Brown. There is that old song, you know, John Brown's body lies a mauldron in the grave. It's not exactly true because some of him is decorating my wall. That was a Christmas gift from my sister. I got her a DVD player. So here we are in my office, as they would say on MTV Cribs. This is where the magic happens. Of course, on MTV Cribs, then a rapper will be, you know, showing off his solid gold sink or something. For me, that would just be my little iMac here, I guess, because this is what I do. So basically, being a writer is very visually exciting because all you do is just, you know, sit here and think things and then, you know, go like this. So I've been the voice of Violet for over 2 years now because these animated films take so long, I guess, because they're all hard or something. And so in the whole time that I've been Violet, I've been writing a book. It's called Assassination Vacation, and it's about the assassinations of Presidents Lincoln, Garfield, and McKinley, and tourism. So I go to historic sites having to do with those assassinations and then come here and, you know, write about them.
plaques get a lot of play. Let's just say, if you want to hear about plaques, I'm your girl. I mean, I hope what I knew is make American history interesting, but I really do have to pitch it to people. You know, I really have to say, James A. Garfield really is interesting, whereas The Incredibles has been incredible for me because, unlike anything I've ever worked on, my friends and family find it fascinating, you know, right off the bat. Like, ooh, a family of superheroes. Exciting! It's just been so nice to be part of something that I don't have to convince people to be interested in, you know? It's just so much more relaxing, really. I'm better with dead people, I discovered, more than the living, so I like writing about them. So here I am in the morning, I'm writing about the Republican Convention of 1880, and then the afternoon I'd get to say things like, the robot lost its claw! That is just something you never get to say when you're talking about the Garfield administration. You know, and like, the robot slipped! The robot's falling down! And it's just such a nice break from, you know, oh, Garfield's dying. I didn't know if I could be a superhero. I didn't know if I could act, and I certainly didn't know if I could act like a superhero. We can do it again if you want. So Pixar sent me this package of drawings of all the characters, and they were in their superhero uniforms, and they looked very sleek and very can-do and capable, and I really didn't know if I could pull that off. And then I come to this one drawing of Violet and all of her classmates at her high school, and it is just one shiny, happy teenager after another. They look polite and well-mannered and upbeat. And then I notice Violet, and she's wearing these baggy, dark clothes, and she has her hands in her pockets, and she's kind of hiding behind her hair. And that's when I know that kid, I can be that kid, the gloomy, sarcastic teenager who, you know, just is so uncomfortable and in her shell all the time, especially at school. Like, I can fake that.
Don't be silly. You're beautiful.
I'm gangly.
You're growing.
I'm gangly and growing ganglier. I'm ugly. I have no curves. My friends are dorkier than I am. I can't talk, but my brain won't shut up. So how it happened, you know, that I got sucked into Pixar world was the documentary that the Pixar people heard about me and my father's homemade cannon on the radio. In radio, we paint a picture out of sound. It uses a lot of imagination, unlike this film crap. So anyway, since you're watching this film, then you must be a fan of animation, which is drawing, so I thought maybe I could, like, draw you through it so, you know, I could put you there. Like, here's me. This is my dad. We load up my dad's cannon. We drive up into the mountains. We're shooting it off. One hiker's like, what? And I have this super long radio microphone, and then it's all loud, and the hiker says, that's quite the machine you got there. And he's talking about me and my long radio microphone. That's when I realized that my dad and I are the same person. Pixar did a test animation to that documentary. Weird. This is like a cartoon. Oh my God. Oh, there's smoke everywhere. It's like the 4th of July. Oh, beautiful forest. I really like Abraham Lincoln. He, to me, is a superhero. Even though I love Lincoln as a guy and I love him as a writer, the thing I love about him is that he actually did something, you know? Like, he took the, you know, biggest, most embarrassing, horrible problem this country has ever known, you know, what, like, slavery and what we're gonna do about it, and that we just, you know, for generations and decades either ignore or bicker about and no one does anything. And finally, you know, he ends it. Emancipation, proclamation. He did it. It's over, done, you know? And so I have a lot of pictures of him and prints and, you know, painting. And I also have a little collection of heads, Lincoln heads. There are a couple of bronze ones and this Lincoln totem pole, because there actually is a totem pole of Abraham Lincoln in Alaska, and so I have a souvenir of that. I think of them as my action figures. So that was one of my first questions. Am I going to be an action figure? Not just because an inert person would like to be an action figure once in my life, but also because I would love to be Super Ant, and my nephew Owen plays with all kinds of action figures and toys, you know, and I would like to replace Tyrannosaurus Rex in his heart, I think. And so I have it on good authority that this is the Violet action figure, and so I'm seeing it for the first time, and because I have no superpowers, I'm going to use scissors. Cool. Here's Violet, and it's Invisible Violet. Violet, I have someone I'd like you to meet. Violet, Abe, Violet, Abe. I am the least super heroic person ever born. I can't drive. I can't swim. I'm afraid of heights. I have all these allergies, you know, pet dander, wheat, springtime, basically. But I am a perfect alter ego, you know. I am the perfect person to get changed into something, you know, grander and better than she is.
May I say that it's an incredible pleasure to be here?
Mr. Incredible, I think it's fair to say that you've been pretty busy with the release of The Incredibles. Why don't you tell me what it's been like with all this activity going on in your life?
Well, it's been fun. I mean, I didn't really do anything. I mean, they paid me a fee to use elements of my life story. Hey, we're still waiting for the check, by the way. But come on. It's a cartoon. It's a computer-generated, exaggerated thing. These characters don't look anything like me or my family.
Okay, you look really pretty great in this movie. I'm guessing not plastic surgery. I'd put my money on maybe special training?
No, it's a cartoon. You know, I mean, the filmmakers, they exaggerate things. They want to make things more extreme. But let's be real here, all right? I was never that out of shape. Ever.
Well, you know what they say, the camera adds 10 pounds. And I'm sticking to that. Now, have you been tempted to use any of your superpowers in your real life?
Well, all the time. Have I mentioned that we haven't gotten our check yet? But seriously, you can't hide who you are. It's in your blood. We're all of us are blessed with certain abilities. And I think the film shows that accurately. Even if they did exaggerate the weight part. That's what animation is. It's animated.
Nancy, I love that outfit.
Thanks. Elastigirl, good to see you. You look great. So, Elastigirl, now that you have finished filming The Incredibles, are you looking forward to getting back to your regular life and settling down a little bit?
Look,
I didn't really make the movie. We just gave Pixar permission to be inspired by, I guess is a legal term, our lives.
Stop coming in the house! You sit down! You sit down!
You'll be poor!
This whole movie is a cartoon, you know?
You know, we're so used to seeing male superheroes. What's it like, girlfriend, being a female superhero?
I presume you mean being a female in a game played mostly by men. Am I tough? Is that what you mean?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. I can handle myself in action. And I think that part of the film is accurate.
There were a lot of scenes that looked quite dangerous in this movie. How'd you pull it off?
You know, our story is about explosions and hugs. Warmth.
Not
love.
You!
Family.
Let go of your brother.
I just wish the filmmakers didn't feel the need to exaggerate everything. I'm not saying the film is libelous, but our lawyers are looking into it.
It is so cool to be here. And believe me, I know cool.
Frozone, good to see you, man. Great name, by the way. And, of course, I know the answer to this question, but for those who haven't seen The Incredibles, what exactly is your superpower?
Let's just put it this way. When I tell someone to freeze, they do.
I bet they do. Now, I got to tell you, you and Mr. Incredible, you play best friends in the film, right?
Ah, Incredible!
Hey, Frozone!
Man, I'm not in the movie. It's a cartoon. Do I look like a cartoon to you?
Kinda. But my question is, though, do you guys kind of hang out in real life together?
You calling this real life? This is TV, man. What was the question again? Oh. Do I hang with Mr. I? Oh, yeah. Hey, yeah, I hang with him.
Ice of you to drop by.
Never heard that one before.
Although not always with the utmost enthusiasm.
This is just sad.
We have a report on a fire.
A fire? We're close!
Yeah, baby!
Get caught.
But we respect each other's abilities.
You can't run out of ice! I thought you could use the water in the air!
There is no water in this air!
What's your excuse? Run out of muscle?
What's your next project?
Next project? The Incredibles is a movie. Frozone is real. Best way to see me in action is to be someplace that needs justice. You know how to spell justice. Just ice.
This is incredibly exciting.
Hold on.
For you.
Edna, thank you for talking with us. My first question is, you've created designs for people all over the world and now Hollywood. So tell me about a fashion fiasco that you would rather forget.
I'd rather forget the way I am portrayed in this movie. That is the fiasco.
All visitors are required to make a report.
Go check the electric fence or something. What is it? Who are you? What do you want?
Pull yourself together! I am not abrasive. Wouldn't you agree, darling?
So I'm going to go out on a limb here, Edna. What do you think of my outfit?
Skip down to the interesting questions, darling.
So, Edna, what was it like working with director Brad Bird?
I was paid to allow this fiction to go forward. Mr. Bird was unwilling to work with someone of my stature. I used to design for gods. Your suit can stretch as far as you can without injuring yourself. Virtually indestructible. And machine washable, darling. That's a new feature.
And rumor is superheroes are difficult to work with. True?
Superheroes are easy, darling. This is a hobo suit, darling. Oh, you can't be seen in this. I won't allow it. 15 years ago, maybe, but now...
What do you mean? You designed it.
I never look back, darling. It distracts from the now. Mediocrity is much more difficult to work with, and it is in such great supply.
Some rice cakes.
I mean, I can break through walls. I just can't really get this.
Showtime.
No matter how many times you save the world, it always manages to get back in jeopardy again. I feel like the maid. I just cleaned up this mess. Can we keep it clean for 10 minutes?
I'm at the top of my game. I'm right up there with the big dogs. Girls, come on. Leave the saving of the world to the men? I don't think so.
Super ladies, they're always trying to tell you their secret identity. Think it'll strengthen the relationship or something like that.
Edna Mode. Your suit can stretch as far as you can and still retain its shape. Virtually indestructible and machine washable, darling. That That's a new feature.
Honey, where's my super suit? Where is my super suit? You tell me where my suit is, woman!
What's the toughest thing about being a superhero? Trying to live a normal life. Whether it's pumping up.
I got it!
Dinner with the family.
Stop running in the house!
No! Hey, no force field!
You sit down! You sit down!
No,
or seeing old friends.
Hey, Lucius!
Hey, Speedo!
You are one distracted guy. I know you miss being a hero and your job is frustrating. I just want you to know how much it means to me that you stay at it anyway.
Honey.
Hello, Mr. Incredible.
About the job.
We know who you are.
Something's happened.
We have a new assignment for you.
What?
Showtime.
The supers aren't gone. You can still do great things.
Leave the saving the world to the men?
Honey, where's my super suit?
Why do you need to know?
I don't think so.
Your sword can stretch as far as you can and still retain its shape. Virtually indestructible. And that machine washable, darling, that's a new feature.
Superheroes. What can happen?
Uh-oh. Oh, my back!
The Adventures of Mr. Incredible with his pals Frozone and Mr. Skipperdoo. When last we left them, Mr. Incredible and Frozone had just discovered the startling disappearance of the West River Bridge.
Frozone, the disappearance of the West River Bridge is startling. What dastardly demon could have done such a dirty deed?
This is one wild scene, Big Daddy. What's up with Mr. Skipperdoo?
He's found something. A rivet from the missing bridge. And it's radioactive.
Radioactive? That's powerful goodness. But isn't that dangerous in the wrong hands?
Yes, and what pretty hands they are. For this is blue radioactivity, which can only be the work of one person. The sinister, yet lovely, Lady Lightbug.
Let's make like a banana and split.
Hold on there, Frozone. We can't leave this traffic piled up. There's nothing more important than keeping our country's automobiles on the go.
Well, this will get all those Hepcats rolling for now. Cool it!
Amazing! You're constructing a temporary bridge of ice! I've never seen anything like it! Good job, old friend. Now let's go find Lady Lightbug. With traffic flowing for now, our heroes embark on a search for their evil adversary.
How did you peg this as Lady Lightbug's pet?
Evil is attracted to dark, remote places. And this abandoned fairground is dark and remote.
Dig it, Daddy-O.
Well, she's not under this abandoned funhouse. And she's not under this abandoned shooting gallery. And she's not under this abandoned house of mirrors. What is it, Mr. Skipperdoo?
He's found the bridge.
The bridge? The bridge!
Yes, the bridge!
Lady Lightbug!
By stealing the world's bridges, I will create massive traffic jams. With the people of the Earth unable to commute to work, the economies of the free world will crumble!
That's one crazy bug.
Radioactive silk!
And there is nothing you can do to stop me, Incredible!
You mean Mr. Incredible.
Your Ferris wheel attack is as pathetic and ineffective as your system of government!
Laugh now, Lightbug, for nothing can defeat the power of freedom. It's showtime!
No!
The world is like crazy safe again, thanks to you, Mr. Incredible.
No, Frozone, thanks to you. And democracy. And of course you, Mr. Skipperdoo.
Hope you remembered to poke some holes in that jar.
Curse you, Mr. Incredible, and Frozone, and Mr. Skipperdoo!
Tune in next week for another amazing adventure.
I'll crush you, Mr. Incredible.
Starring the world's greatest super, Mr. Incredible.
Agent Rick Dicker, file 93718. The files of the National Supers Agency are hereby sealed in accordance with the Superhero Restriction Act, banning all supers activity. These files contain highly classified information regarding the supers, their powers,
Bud Lucky is one of the true unsung heroes of animation. Bud helped design most of the films we've made from Toy Story on. He was the fifth animator hired here at Pixar.
He had 20, 30 years of a career in hand-drawn animation, decided, I'll do computer stuff. So right away, we were using him in story work, design. He has such a strong sense of design, his own personal sense of design.
Bounden is different from any other film that we've done, and that's as it should be. It represents what he is. It doesn't represent anybody else. This Bounden is Bud Lucky's film. It's Bud Lucky.
I'm from Montana, and I thought that to have a sympathetic character, the most pathetic thing I could think of was a newly shaven sheep standing in the rain. And then I thought, it's fun to have a mythical character of some sort. And on the Great Plains, it's the jackalope. I wanted to do a Western waltz, and I wanted the story to be like your old uncle talking to you, something like that, an old cowboy. My favorite bird's a meadowlark. And the first few notes are... So I started with that little tune, but it took a lot of plunking. Originally, I did the scratch track with myself on the banjo. And once that was approved, we went back to Nashville. And Joey Miskelin, who is with the Riders in the Sky, did a wonderful arrangement. We sheared sheep on the front lawn. We had some tap dance classes. We rode carousels. Anything for research. It might seem a little too much, but that stuff pays off. Because they come in here every morning and it's just a new world to see what these guys do. I think it's so much better than what I had in my head.
I love it when you can see the stamp of a unique, particular designer and see that on the screen. Bud's designs in Bounden are right there. He designed all the characters in that film, and there they are.
I think the one thing I will thank Bud for more than anything else is Bud is the one that made Woody a cowboy in Toy Story.
John gives me credit with designing Woody, but I did 200 Woodies, and he picked the right one.
Not only did Bud Lucky write, direct, and do all the voices in Bounden, but he also is the voice of Agent Rick Dicker in The Incredibles.
We've frozen all of Syndrome's assets. If he even sneezes...
Brad wanted me to do it in the scratch track.
Great.
And for some reason, he liked it, so I ended up doing it.
If he even sneezes, we'll be there with a hanky and a pair of handcuffs.
About 30 years ago, I'd done some Sesame Street stuff. A friend of mine, Don Hadley.
6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, ladybugs came to the ladybugs picnic.
I like to think these days that 30 years ago, I used animation to teach kids their numbers, and now these kids are teaching me how to animate with numbers. So it was a good deal.
Thank you.
Now, some of you have been complaining that we spend too much time memorizing meaningless facts for the sole purpose of passing tests. Well, here's one more fact for you to memorize.
Nobody cares.
Okay? I put in a full day for low wages, and I don't need any guff. Okay, look, here's how it works. I pretend to teach, you pretend to learn. You pass the test, the school keeps its funding, you move to the next grade, the process is repeated until you enter the workforce where hopefully no one will give you any guff!
The bar sailed!
Ooh, magic.
That's how you do it, kids.
Oh, this, all this
he was playing with matches.
Come on.
He's always ready for his close-up.
Grand plié.
We can't have it inside the base.
Get that?
And that's Mark.
Yeah, baby! You're gonna get it done.
Yeah.
Now you're gonna get it done.
Yeah.
And it's gonna be fun.
We do want Brad to be able to look at it.
Frank Thomas and Ollie Johnston are two of Disney's legendary nine old men and two of the greatest animators that ever lived. I was lucky enough to know them since the age of 11 when I first visited the Disney studios. And I've kept in touch with them ever since, showing them my work and getting their feedback on it. And The Incredibles was no exception. I showed them the early story reels got their impressions on what they felt was working and what needed work.
There are places where you need to see them thinking and planning a little more.
Yeah, I think such a big difference when you know the characters and which side they're on and what they're trying to do, even when they don't know what to do yet.
I've tried to pay tribute to them by putting them in not only The Iron Giant, my first film, but also in The Incredibles in CG form.
See that? Yeah, that's the way to do it. That's old school.
Yeah? No school like the old school.
While Frank didn't live long enough to see the finished film, I think he would like it. And Ollie, I'm hoping he's there on opening day. In any case, I was very gratified to see them make the leap from hand-drawn to CG animation in The Incredibles.
Take one. Take two. Take three. Take four. Take five. Take six. Take seven.
Dad.
Yeah, and I'm the dad. Aha! Got it!
Hey, chill out.
At the beginning of the production, there was some question as to whether or not we'd be able to get this done on time and under budget. This is my little way of showing that it could be done.
We have a backup in case everything fails.
Mark Kobayashi, thank God, has finished the film with sock puppets. And we've got that for your viewing pleasure this morning.
Elastigirl, what are you doing here?
I thought you could use some help.
I had the situation well under control.
He's got a point.
You need to be more flexible.
Monsieur incroyable.
And incredible.
Buddy?
Buddy?
Marriage is a lot of hard work.
We're superheroes. What could go wrong?
Ding dong.
Lucius!
Hey, everybody.
I miss being a superhero.
Yeah, those were the days.
I know. Let's go save some people. We better not do that again.
Yeah.
Money, money, money. Bob, listen to me.
I can't believe I got fired. What am I gonna do? The secret thing won't fall out of my briefcase. I can't believe I got fired. What am I gonna do?
Our top secret robot has gone out of control. We need you to destroy it. If you accept, we'll pay you the equivalent of 1 year's salary.
I started with the baby suit. It's fireproof, bulletproof, and machine washable, darling. That's a new feature.
So, Mr. Incredible, we meet again.
Buddy?
You are Elastigirl. Find him.
Kids, what are you doing here?
What's going on? They tried to kill us all.
The first thing we're going to do is not panic.
Hey, who are those kids? Get them!
Remember what Mom told us.
What?
Take that, you hussy!
But she was trying to rescue me.
I'm supposed to rescue you.
Mom!
Dad!
Kids, you're all right.
Mr. Incredible and Elastigirl? And you two got busy. Well, I'm off to destroy a city and become a hero. People of the city, do not fear, for I, Syndrome, will save you!
Yay! Oh no!
Yay! I have your son, and I will raise him to be a supervillain! Ha 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 ha!
Actual cake eating disturbs me to watch because I saw that footage. Dave Mullins did the animation. And he actually sat down the giant piece of cake. Actually, he bought a whole cake.
His wife made the cake.
Is that what happened?
Yeah, his wife made the cake for him.
And he just showed me all this footage of him scarfing back a giant piece of cake and delivering the line. And, he ate the whole cake in about 20 minutes. It was just disgusting.
You should put that footage on the DVD.
Yeah.
No, this is a little
Thank you.
did that.